Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 22nd meeting of the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee in 2022. Before I begin, can I remind everyone using electronic devices to switch them to silent. I'd also like to welcome Edward Mountain to the committee this morning. Our first item of business this morning is our concluding evidence session on the Hunting with Dogs Scotland Bill at Stage 1. And I'm pleased to welcome to the meeting the Minister for Environment and Land Reform and our officials, Hugh Dignan, Head of Wildlife and Flood Management Unit, Leah Fitzgerald, Team Leader from the Wildlife Legislation Team, and Hazel Riley, the lawyer from the Scottish Government. And I invite the Minister to make some opening remarks.
Thanks very much, Convener, and thank you to the committee for having us today. Although it has been unlawful for 20 years, we know that mammals continue to be chased and to be killed by packs of dogs in Scotland, whether that's inadvertently by those undertaking management or deliberately by those participating in illegal activities such, for example, as hare coursing. So my intention is to ensure that what has been unlawful for 20 years cannot persist, and to deliver legislation which very clearly sets out the purposes for which dogs can be used and the conditions that must be adhered to when using dogs. Now, in his review, Lord Bonamy noted that the existing legislation lacks clarity and is unduly complicated, and this has resulted in difficulties in bringing prosecutions under the Act. So I was very pleased to hear Lord Bonamy's comments in front of your committee, Convener, that he considers this bill to be a very well-crafted piece of legislation and that it should be a great incentive to better enforcement of the law. So as well as clarifying the legal position, the bill also introduces a two-dog limit for searching for, stalking and flushing wild mammals. This, we believe, is an important additional safeguard to reduce the risk of foxes and other wild mammals being chased and being killed by packs of dogs. It will significantly reduce the risk of dogs not being under control, again, whether inadvertently or deliberately, and so leading, as it has done in those circumstances, to the chasing and killing of mammals by dogs. Now, the vast majority of foxes in Scotland are controlled without using dogs at all. The bill, however, allows for the use of two dogs to protect livestock without licences. But in these circumstances, I recognise, as Lord Bonamy did, that there are circumstances where two dogs are not going to be sufficient to undertake that lawful activity of flushing a mammal to waiting guns. And that can be because of, for example, terrain in thick forest or on hill ground. And because of this, the bill includes provision for more than two dogs to be used via a licensing scheme where it can be demonstrated that there was no other solution. I just want to be clear on two points, however. Applying for a licence should be the exception, and Nature Scot, as the licensing authority, would need to scrutinise applications. But the second point that I want to be clear about is that where a licence is merited for use, we're determined that it will be workable, reasonable, and available. Very briefly, as I know we'll get into more detail on that in the discussion, but the other main policy provision in the bill is the banning of trail hunting. The reasons for this are twofold. Firstly, trail hunting poses a significant risk to wild mammals who can be diverted from a laid trail onto a natural trail and start chasing and killing wild mammals. But secondly, we know from evidence down south that trail hunting is used as a cover for unlawful hunting, and we therefore want to take this opportunity not just to close historic loopholes but to rise to the opportunity of preventing others from opening. So I've been following your committee sessions. I'm aware of some of the discussions that have arisen with regards to the bill. It's very helpful for me to hear these, and I'm glad to have the opportunity to hear more of them for today. But for now, I'll just say that I understand that the control of wild mammals is a controversial issue. I know you've heard strong views on either side of the debates. This bill is principally about pursuing the highest possible animal welfare standards in Scotland, but doing so on the understanding that we are a rural nation and that access to legitimate control must be possible. And I'll leave it there, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We have about 90 minutes for questions. My first question was to be what the bill's overall purpose is, but I think in your opening statement you've covered most of that. But can I ask, is this bill really a sledgehammer to crack a nut? What level of deliberate or unintentional law-breaking is there under the existing bill, given that you've said that the vast majority of fox control is not with dogs? And taking that into consideration, is this new bill not based on the principle of evidence and whatever, but more to do with just prejudice and stopping mounted packs?
So I'll take, I'll maybe take them in reverse order. There's absolutely no prejudice in the pursuit of this whatsoever. This is, as I set out, the government pursuing highest possible animal welfare standards, but necessarily seeking to find a balance, because we also recognise that we need to be able, that farmers, land managers, conservationists will in certain circumstances have to be able to control wild mammals. There's a very, very simple basis underlying what can be a complicated bill or a controversial issue, which is that this has already been unlawful for 20 years. And it's on the back of Lord Bonamy and concerns from the public. Our intention now is to make what ought to have happened 20 years ago work. And I think you asked me a question about, to what extent is this a sledgehammer to crack a nut? Well, I think, and my officials will correct me if I'm wrong, but I think that Lord Bonamy in his report identified that about 20% of all foxes that are killed using dogs in Scotland are killed unlawfully. He was nodding. But so there was a substantial proportion there. Like, I accept that other methods of fox control, mammal control, are used that don't necessarily involve dogs. But I think we would all agree that where dogs are used, we ought to pursue the highest possible standards of welfare.
Perhaps you just clarify. 20% seems to be a huge number, given the evidence we've heard about packs or foot packs and whatever. 20% unlawfully killed seem to be very, very high, given the vast number are not controlled using dogs.
20% is the figure that I recall, convener, but I'll certainly check it.
Okay, thanks very much. Karen Adam.
Thank you, convener. And good morning.
Morning.
Minister, sorry. In the early stages of the bill, the purpose was to address any inconsistencies in the language of the 2002 Act, mm-hmm. and to make the law easier to understand and to enforce. During the course of our scrutiny, has there been any gaps that you now feel require further clarification, or any aims or objectives that you feel have changed? And if so, in what way?
Well, I've been listening carefully, and my officials have been listening carefully to the discussion as it's played out. And I think there's been a range of issues brought up. I think some of them have pertain to, for example, terms which are defined and those which aren't. I know that there has also been points raised about should we have an additional offence of reckless conduct. And I'm listening to all of these, and I'm happy to discuss any in particular. On the point about reckless conduct, I think that was one that I thought about particularly closely, because it went right to the core of what is the offence. So right now we have the offence, or we're proposing the offence of hunting. We're proposing a second offence of knowingly permitting, and I understand there were some calls for there to be an additional reckless conduct. For me, one of the principal aims, in fact, the principal aim is to have clarity of expression and understanding, not just for those who would seek to use dogs in pursuit of legitimate activities, but also for law enforcement. And I think when we add a degree of subjectivity with something like reckless conduct, we're getting back into the ambiguities that were the problem in the 2002 Act. So I place a lot of attention on under control as it's part of this bill, because I think that that's going to be an absolutely key provision. It's central to this bill. When it's passed, it should be very, very clear to any observer or anyone who would want to undertake control of wild mammals when they have the dogs under control. and when they don't. That's what we were lacking before. That's what I want to maintain. But those are just some examples. But if there are other specific issues that have been raised with the committee that you would like to speak with me about, I'm more than happy to talk about them. I also mentioned the issue of, you know, defining terms and not defining terms. Mm. We've tried to where the natural meaning of a term we think has been quite straightforward. We've tried not to unnecessarily enclose it within a definition, because we know that when we try and do exhaustive definitions, you naturally will miss things, mm. and that will allow, frankly, those who would seek to circumvent this to say, well, I was undertaking activity that was out with your definition, and it just makes it more complicated. Mm. So we tried to avoid that where we can. But those were some of the examples that had occurred to me.
That's great. Thank you.
Thank you. I get a supplementary view, Mercedes Villalba, and then Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the witnesses.
Morning.
Thank you for coming. Just a related question. In terms of the definition of hunting, are you satisfied with that? We've heard calls that it should be clarified with an expanded list of related terms such as stalking, flushing or pursuing. What's your view on that?
So I'm just trying to remind myself exact. So we refer to it as searching for, stalking and flushing. So that's exactly one of the examples that I was referring to Karen Adam about, whereby if we tried to provide an exhaustive definition of hunting, we would eventually find ourselves in a circumstance where people would say, I wasn't undertaking any of those activities, I was something else, and you find yourself outside the scope of it. But in terms of expanding a non-exhaustive list of what that could constitute, you know, I don't disagree with that. That might be something that could be helpful.
Thank you. And what are your views on, there's been a suggestion that there should be a strict liability under Section 2 of the bill where a landowner or occupier or dog owner would be liable?
That will come up in, okay. in future questions. Can I just, we were touching on the definition. On the face of the bill, it suggests that hunting includes in particular searching for and coursing, and then in brackets and related expressions are to be construed accordingly. Does that not allow a huge amount of uncertainty about what that might be, and how would that be interpreted in law?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a good question, and I think there's always a balance to be struck, because I've been talking to Mercedes Villalba and Karen Adam about the risks of having a defined definition and finding yourself out with it. Of course, there's a risk of having so many terms that, you know, it could become broader than we had anticipated. I don't think that's the case with what we have set out, and I think that searching for, stalking, flushing are terms which people readily understand and will understand as being part of the intentional act of hunting.
But the addition to the end of that, does that not then leave it open that it's not just that, it's what can be construed by individuals? Does that not make it far more woolly?
I don't think it's woolly. I think it's deliberately not closing off what could constitute hunting. And that all comes back to the fact that we found ourselves under the 2002 Act with interpretations being taken outside of the bill and prosecution and behaviour not following what was expected under the bill. So it's deliberately non-exhaustive.
Okay. Briefly.
Thanks very much, Kavir. Good morning.
Morning.
One of the points that was raised last week, I think it was last week, can't remember, the weeks were running at each other, about hunting, flushing, etc. One of the issues that was raised was the potential for shooting pheasants, shooting game birds, mm-hmm. and dogs flush a rabbit out, and that is then perceived to be a criminal offence. But if a dog doesn't chase that rabbit and kill it, is that an offence or is it not? If they flush it, but they don't chase and kill it. So it's what we need to get clarity on what the offence actually is.
So it wouldn't apply to game birds?
No, but in the process of them flushing game birds, if a rabbit or a fox comes out and the dog doesn't chase that rabbit or fox to kill it, mm-hmm. therefore no offence is being made. Is that correct?
Yeah. Hugh's telling me that's correct, so I'm just going to let him come in and maybe expand on that, Hugh.
Well, I think, you know, the key point is around intent here. There is clearly no intent in that situation. And, I mean, there is no breach of the law if the dog doesn't chase the rabbit anyway. If the rabbit is just flushed, clearly no offence, I would say.
And I think that links in with a discussion which I understand you've had about, OK, what if you're walking your dog in the countryside?
Yes.
And that's exactly what Hugh described there. Hunting is an intentional act. Walking your dog, if it chases after a rabbit or a hare or a fox and kills it, you haven't committed a crime under this Act because you weren't undertaking the very intentional hunting. Now, that's not to say that if you repeatedly, actively allowed your dog to do that, that it couldn't eventually constitute something more. But walking your dog and it breaking free and chasing and killing a mammal is not a crime under this Act.
My specific concern is for game birds and dogs flushing out other than game birds. That the concern that we heard from one of the witnesses was that last week or the week before said that would then constitute an offence, but we're now saying that that wouldn't constitute an offence.
Yeah, because of the intent behind
the
activity.
Thank you.
Can I get some clarity on that?
Yeah, I have real problems with this. So, across the country, there's rough shoots. At the moment, they're perfectly legal. Mm-hmm. So you may have half a dozen people with a couple of Labradors or three Labradors that will go in and flush pheasants. But there's also rabbits in there. So the intention is to flush, which is defined as hunting in the bill. So if a fox or a rabbit is flushed and that fox or rabbit is shot, or the dogs continue to, you know, to flush, there's a problem, there's a potential impact on rough shooting. You know, it was Police Scotland last week, and I quote, "It's a difficult one. That is where intent would come into it, and it might be difficult to differentiate. That opportunity is also going to be there. If dogs are flushing game legally but encounter a mammal and chase it, that risk is there. I do not know whether that is necessarily addressed by the bill." So that is my concern. That is probably a very, very common occurrence at the weekends where a rough shoot into mixed gorse or whatever, where there will be pheasants, but there'll also be rabbits. If there's three dogs in those gorse bushes, you know, you could say you don't intend your dog to chase rabbits, but it will flush them. And that is hunting. So can you tell us where in the bill that point would be clarified? Because Police Scotland, and if I remember, the Fiscal also had issues over how that would be determined.
OK. I'll try and give my explanation as I understand it, and then I can bring in my team if need be. So, first of all, if going back to this point of intent, if you set out with the purpose of a combination of game shooting and the control of wild mammals, and that's the activity that you're pursuing, then this bill will apply, the two-dog limit will apply, and you will have to comply with the terms of this bill. If you go out only for game shooting, i.e. not in pursuit of a wild mammal, with no intention of pursuing a wild mammal, then the bill will not apply. And in those circumstances, I would expect that if the dogs that you were using went after a wild mammal, that wasn't intentional, and you wouldn't be caught by the bill. But I appreciate perhaps this needs clarity. I'll see if my colleagues have got anything to add to what I've said. And Hazel from our legal department is coming in.
Yeah, I'm happy to come in there. Thank you, Minister. Just to clarify the definition of hunting in the bill, it's not an exhaustive definition, as the Minister has explained. It includes searching for and coursing. Flushing is an exception to that practice, but the reason we haven't included flushing in the definition of hunting is there could be scenarios where flushing takes place where that is not part of hunting, in the example that you've given. So in that scenario, should you use two dogs to flush game birds? If a rabbit was to dart out and the person intending to shoot game birds left that rabbit alone, then that would not be an offence under the bill.
Beg your pardon. So that effectively means that a mixed shoot will now become legal, despite the fact there is no evidence to suggest there's any animal welfare issues relating to that.
Well, I think our intention with this bill is that anyone who sets out to control wildlife in the Scottish countryside should abide by it. Now, if that means that you're doing a joint shoot with game not caught by the bill and with wild mammals caught by the bill, then you're caught by the bill.
But it's not necessarily controlling. You know, people don't go out to shoot pheasants to control pheasants. But as a
pheasants
consequence
aren't caught
of...
caught by the bill, though.
I understand that. But if you go out to for a rough or a mixed shoot, which is not necessarily about controlling wild mammals, that includes pheasants and game, but there may be rabbits flushed, that would be illegal under this bill.
If you're pursuing an activity and the dogs that you're using flush a rabbit, that's a wild mammal. This is about the protection of wild mammals in Scotland, and the bill will apply. I think, Hugh, do you want to come in?
Yeah, but I think it's only if it's more than two dogs. So I think the answer is if you're involved in a rough shoot and you think you might be shooting rabbits as well as game birds, then you need to limit yourself to two dogs. If it's more than two dogs, then certainly the provisions of the bill will apply.
OK, thanks. Rachel Hamilton.
I think, obviously, we need to make this workable and practical, Minister, and that's one of your intentions.
Yeah,
I know that. I think this... And also, you use the term loopholes, and the definition of a loophole is one person's perspective of a reasonable defence. And so this therefore brings in the argument around the defence, proving a defence around hare coursing. We know that hundreds of people go out on a rough shoot and they don't intend to go and shoot rabbits. However, and they take more than two dogs. And I think it's just slightly strange that we would be wanting to limit the number of dogs for people who are not intending. So there could be a spurious allegation on this as well, which would, you know, would that rough shoot then be stopped? Or the other thing is, could, on a workable sense, we look at something on an exemption which would cover permission to be on the land? And then we wouldn't have to look at an individual who has three spaniels that are very well controlled, but something might happen and it runs off to a rabbit, unintended, of course, and they will be able to prove their defence. But could we look at something that was an exception within the bill to cover that?
I think there's two points there. One is about us clarifying the application of the bill as to the different types of shooting activity that people might undertake, and it not applying to game, but applying to wild mammals. The second, and perhaps we need clarity on that, and, you know, that's what the process is all about. The second point that you raised about rabbits, well, I have to be clear that one of the policy decisions that we have made here is that that rabbits should be afforded the same protection as hares. Now, it's twofold the reason why we have included rabbits within the bill. Firstly, we accept that there is significant welfare issues when dogs chase and kill hares. We see no reason why that ought not to also apply to rabbits, so we want to bring them within the definition of wild mammal. The second reason that we've brought it in is because we know that the hare coursing, when it's undertaken and when it's caught, is often, people will often say we were shooting rabbits, and we don't want to create that opportunity. Now, the point that you made there, Rachel, about permission to be on land, now that might address the issue of eliminating the opportunity to say that you were shooting rabbits when in fact you're undertaking hare coursing, but it doesn't touch the welfare concerns that we have about rabbits being chased and ripped apart. So that's why they've been included in the bill. And that's why I don't think that permission is enough to negate the need to bring rabbits within the scope of the bill.
Yeah, I am just very concerned. I mean, my own gut instinct here is that we should have had a separate piece on hare coursing, because as somebody who's been witness to that with people getting away, I felt very passionately about the fact that they're not being caught, and the Police Scotland had talked about that last week. And I think that using other things within the countryside that are, you know, rural pursuits that are very acceptable, and then bringing hare coursing in that and trying to work a system which can make sure that we prosecute more people who are, you know, doing that awful thing and not getting caught, I think it's a very difficult line to tread to wrap it all in together.
Okay. No, I take your point, and I've been watching quite closely what others have had to say, and I have seen a lot of support actually for the inclusion of rabbits within the definition of wild mammal And just, you know, for the purposes of the record, I know that Detective Sergeant Telford said Police Scotland welcomes the inclusion of rabbits. Chief and Superintendent Mike Flynn, the SSPCA, we welcome the inclusion of rabbits. Lord Bonamy, on the definition of a wild mammal, my only comment is that it makes sense to protect rabbits for the reason that is given. To me, that's common sense.
Minister, just for the record, I also support that, but okay. I think we need to find a workable and practical solution to ensuring that this bill isn't just a sort of a catch-all. If you know what I mean.
Yeah,
we're going to move on. This will probably come up later in question. Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. Just to check, I've got questions on the next couple of themes. Do you want me to run into them or come back to you?
No, if you just cover your first question just now, Alistair, thank you.
Returning to the process, as it were, by which the government came to its bill, we've heard from Lord Bonamy, who said fairly positive things about the bill, although it doesn't include everything that was in his report. He seemed to think it was a well-drafted piece of legislation. But can I ask a little bit about what the thinking was about how to get from Bonamy to the bill and what alternatives were considered on the way?
Yeah, absolutely. So Bonamy was a really important part of our development of the terms of this legislation, so were two public consultations and, of course, extensive and deliberately wide-ranging stakeholder consultation that we've undertaken. So, yes, we have implemented a lot of what Bonamy recommended. We decided not to pursue his recommendation on vicarious liability or, indeed, on the reverse burden of proof. I'm happy to go into more detail on that if the committee would like, but I think you've already discussed quite a bit about that. I suppose the two-dog limit itself wasn't recommended explicitly. Two dogs were not recommended by Bonamy. What he did say was that there was evidence that foxes were being unlawfully chased and killed, and I think he's subsequently said that the combination of the two-dog limit together with the licensing scheme is a workable and the proper approach to that. In terms of alternative approaches, I think probably one of the main alternative approaches that we considered was, do we seek to amend the 2002 Act or do we redo the 2002 Act? And I think that some of the feedback we've gotten about the clarity that we've achieved via this bill and the way it's drafted, albeit that we're at the beginning of the parliamentary process, has justified as having taken the approach to pursue the bill as we did.
Thank you, Convener.
Okay, we're now going to move on to section 1 and 2 on offences. Okay. Ariane Burgess.
Thank you, Convener, and I'd like to thank the Minister and her team for being here to provide evidence today. Minister, a 2019 poll found that 77% of Scottish public felt that legislation to protect wild animals from hunting with dogs needs to be strengthened. And much of the evidence received by this committee backs this up. Police Scotland, Lord Bonamy and Chief Superintendent Mike Flynn of the SSPCA have all talked about the challenges of convicting and proving offences under the existing Protection of Wild Mammals Act. Do you believe that this bill will fully resolve these difficulties, or is there scope for amendments to further clarify and define the offences to ensure that, as you previously stated, chasing and killing a mammal with a dog, for sport or otherwise, has no place in modern Scotland?
Thank you for the question. So I think, first of all, do I have confidence that the bill, as it's presented, rises to the challenge of what we were pursuing, i.e. highest possible animal welfare standards, acknowledging the need for control in rural Scotland and doing that to try and rectify what was supposed to have been done 20 years ago. Yes, I think it does do that. However, we are at the beginning of the parliamentary scrutiny process. I absolutely value the input of this process and I'm open-minded to ways in which your committee or indeed those who you bring in front of you think it could be improved. And I'll look forward to having those discussions as we progress this, particularly your stage one report.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. You've touched on the issue of definition of words, particularly relating to Section 1 and 2 offences. and others have discussed with you words like reckless and stalking and flushing, so I'm not going to go over that old ground. But we did have evidence from others who raised other questions, including what it means that a person is reasonably believed that they were acting under an exception, which is section 2.4 of the bill. This was something that was raised with us. So I just wonder if, when it comes to the exceptions, the exemptions that are in the bill or that part of the bill, whether you feel that's a well enough defined term, reasonably believed to be acting under an exception.
Yeah, I think it's... thank you for the question. I think it's an interesting point, and as with some of the other definition points that we've already discussed, the team and I thought quite carefully about the words that were used. The drafters thought quite carefully about the words that were used. I think reasonable is probably one of the ones that I'm more comfortable with, because I think that the judicial system, if I can call it, you know, the whole process from right through, is quite well acquainted with the idea of reasonableness, and making an assessment on that. And it allows you to take the circumstances into account, which of course those interpreting the law must be able to do. So we've used it, as you said, reasonably believed. And I understand, if I'm recalling from memory here, but within, we talk about you having to take reasonable measures to stop two dogs forming with another pack and creating a larger group. So it's pretty standard wording, and I think that the judicial system is quite well acquainted with reasonableness.
Thank you.
Alison, do you want to continue with your question?
Well, the other question I had was around rabbits. And again, you've touched on some of the issues around hair coursing, and others have asked you about that issue. I wonder if I could ask in more general terms, perhaps, about the issue of pest control. Now, some of our previous witnesses don't like the word pest control and feel it may cause offence amongst some species, but I'm going to use it. Are you satisfied that the measures that there are around rabbits and their inclusion in the bill leave adequate room for legitimate pest control?
Yeah, I think it's, again, a good question. So I explained in discussion with Rachel Hamilton about the reasons we've included rabbits' welfare, to bring them into line with, I think, what we all understand as being welfare concerns about hare, but also the second reason being because it's often used as a cover for hare coursing, and we want to avoid that. But, of course, the bill does not prevent the use of the control of rabbits. It doesn't prevent that full stop, and it doesn't stop the use of two dogs to help flush rabbits from cover to waiting guns. So I'm comfortable that there will still be scope for control under the bill. But it will be done in a more humane manner. And it will protect other wild animals in the countryside, and it will allow us to have clarity about when hare coursing is being undertaken.
Thank you, Convener.
Just sticking with rabbits, there is concern, and it was raised by Basque, that including rabbits would affect a significant number of people and how they go about their work. So under Section 3, there's a restriction to killing by means of shooting or by killed by a bird of prey. So, for example, those who are employed or voluntarily use dogs to flush rabbits to nets, which are then caught by hand and dispatched by hand, that would rule that out. There's also using more than two dogs in a spaniel field trial where rabbits were part of the quarry for the day, even though the rabbits are shot. Would you consider further exemptions to ensure that these activities are not covered by the bill?
Sorry, Convener, could you just describe the first scenario again to me, please? You talked about the use of a net.
Yeah, so where we're currently, or the bill would restrict only to use two dogs to flush rabbits into a net, and the Section 3 suggests they need to be killed by a gun or the shooting. Or by using a bird of prey, but it wouldn't allow someone to dispatch them by hand.
I think, and I probably should go away and think about that, but my instinctive response just now is that I wouldn't want to do anything which stopped that sort of transplanting of animals, rather than, you know, I wouldn't want to say they must be killed at the point of flushing if on occasions they can be netted and moved, you know.
Yeah, again, it's all about animal welfare, making sure that they're dispatched in an appropriate way, and limiting the way you dispatch them could potentially remove some methods of pest control.
Yeah.
Thank you. We're now going to look at exceptions in sections 3, 5, 6 and 7. Mercedes Villalba.
Okay. I thought we were somewhere else earlier on, so apologies if my previous supplementaries were off topic. I would like to ask if the Minister could outline the different circumstances where the Scottish Government considers it appropriate to hunt a wild animal using a dog under the exceptions, and when it would be inappropriate.
That's understood. So, just to recap, the bill has two offences, to hunt a mammal with a dog and to knowingly permit. And there are exceptions to that, as Mercedes Villalba has pointed to. The first one is management of wild mammals above ground. This will require two dogs. They'll have to be under control. They'll have to take reasonable steps to make sure that they don't join with others. I think what's envisaged there is farmers, land managers, others having to undertake control in order to protect lambs, poultry, ground nesting birds, and others, basically the use above ground. The second exception is wild mammals below ground, which I know there has been quite extensive discussion about and very opposing views from those that you've heard. Provision there would be for one dog, again under control, again with permission. But again, that's about controlling species such as foxes and mink, but underground. And then there is an exception for falconry, game shooting and deer stalking. Using, for example, a dog to flush a wild animal to then be killed by the falcon, or to be shot to be fed to the falcon, as I understand it. And then the fourth exception is for environmental benefits. And that is for projects, for example, to tackle invasive non-native species. We've seen a couple of those, stoats on Orkney. I understand hedgehogs on Uist was one of the ways that this was used. So there's a few circumstances in which we can envisage that dogs could be used in the pursuit of different activities, and these are laid out in exceptions in the bill.
I think thank the Minister for that response. I think it's fair to say that there's some concern amongst wildlife campaigners that the exceptions cover, they're very broad and they cover quite a lot of circumstances. And so I just wondered if the Minister would like to take the opportunity just to confirm that the intention of the bill is to prohibit all use of dogs to hunt wild animals, and that any exceptions will be applied narrowly and will be subject to rigorous scrutiny.
Every law that the government passes we consider very carefully and we scrutinise closely. But these are reflective of what's required, as we understand it and as stakeholders tell us in rural Scotland. And, you know, it's quite mixed, the reasons why they're used. And, you know, for example, I think that RSPB were welcoming of the fact that there's been an exception for environmental use, because we have to understand that whilst we will want to pursue the highest possible animal welfare standards for our wildlife, there are circumstances in which humans have to control wildlife.
I mean, we did hear from one witness that they would be applying for repeated licences throughout a given season, back to back. And I think there's just a concern that there still remains quite a few loopholes. And I accept the government's intention, but I'm just not sure that's what this bill is going to achieve. But
so I understand your point. I don't consider them to be loopholes, because the basis of this is that the chasing and the killing is unlawful, not the control, not the flushing of an animal to a waiting gun. And I think that with these provisions, we will be able to make sure that unlawful activity, that chasing, the killing, suffering, essentially, will not be able to take place under these provisions. And it does that whilst, you know, being cognisant of life in rural Scotland.
I've got a supplementary from Rachel Hamilton.
Minister,
sorry.
In terms of the bill distinguishing between environmental and livestock protection, how does one differ from another in terms of animal welfare?
But they're so vast. I mean, it's difficult, you know, the protection of a lamb can even be required to take place in different circumstances. Some farmers will lamb indoors, some will lamb on the hill. They have different circumstances. It's virtually impossible for me to say how that then compares to invasive non-native species on an island. And
yes, but how can you prove that the same animal welfare can be improved for using dogs to flush one animal for another for an environmental reason or a predation reason?
So they're pursued for different reasons. So I can't.
But how does the animal welfare improve when you roll in the environmental benefit and the livestock predation at the same time?
Sorry, I'm not really sure what you mean. I suppose I come from this, and pursuing all of these reasons for which a dog may be used, I come from it on the basis that we can't allow an animal in any of those circumstances to be chased and to be killed, because that's where the animal welfare concern is. And so long as we seek to avoid that, whether those dogs are being used to protect, to kill a fox, to protect lambs, or to help eradicate a non-native species, the welfare element is not allowing the chasing and the killing.
Right.
With due respect, I'm trying to just get into your question. Are you suggesting there's different policies and whether that hunting
I didn't want to go into licensing,
control,
because it's going to come up. So yeah, I didn't want to take from somebody else's questions.
No, that's fine.
But I think that could be developed in that question.
Yeah, if we don't get a response to the question you're trying
Thank
to ask,
you.
we'll bring it in at the end. Sorry, Jim Fairley.
Oh, the timings and things, okay.
Your Karen Adam, was it? No? Is it me? All right, my apologies. Thanks so much, Convener. The reasons for the two-dog limit above ground and the Scottish Government's assessment of the different impacts to that limit may have on the ability to control wildlife, on animal welfare, on wild animal disturbances, and the groups that carry out hunting with dogs, etc. What considerations did you give for the two-dog limit above ground, and what were the assessments of the impacts of the two dogs as opposed to a pack?
So the most important point of consideration there was about that control element. So one of the problems under the 2002 Act was determining whether what you were seeing was a flagrant breach of what was intended, i.e. you shouldn't chase or kill a mammal, or whether it's, you know, they had lost control, whether it was deliberate. I want people to be able to look at a scenario and tell whether the law is being complied with or not, and that is much more readily clear when there will be two dogs rather than 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Equally, the as I've said, that the basis of this is protecting wild mammals, and it is far less likely that a wild mammal is going to be chased and killed by a dog when there's two, when they ought to be well kept under control by the person purporting to take them out, than if there are 5, 6, 7, 8 dogs, which you can lose control of, or which it's much less easy to tell when they're chasing and killing. So it's about reducing the opportunity for packs of dogs to chase and kill wild mammals. Equally, England and Wales has a two-dog limit, which they have found to work successfully. So because of those things, the two-dog limit was a reasonable basis with which to start, a baseline. But of course, as you know, we have supplemented it in two circumstances with a licensing scheme to be available when no other methods are available.
Okay. So if you were looking at the assessment from the point of view of an environmental group or a farming body, the use of more than two dogs for walked-up hounds, we've heard throughout sessions, is going to be essential.
A, for the welfare of the dog, the dogs, and also for the welfare of a fox that's going to be flushed, so that they're not going round in circles all day. Did you consider the issues of the welfare of the dogs and the fox while you were putting that number on it? Was it an arbitrary figure? How did you come to the conclusion that two dogs were okay but 12 dogs weren't? Because there's going to be circumstances where there's no other way of getting foxes out of particular cover, and there's going to be an essential way to get them out of there because there's no other way of controlling them.
Yeah.
Did you just give consideration to two? Where did the number come from?
Yeah, so the number is based on, first of all, the fact that it will substantially reduce the ability to kill and chase, but also an assessment of what is possible with two dogs versus what people are seeking to use them for. And as I said in my opening remarks, Lord Bonamy recognised that there would be circumstances in which two dogs was not going to be sufficient. He pointed directly to terrain, he pointed to thick forest, he pointed to hill ground, and that's why, whilst the two dogs was a reasonable baseline, bearing in mind how it helps us keep dogs under control, bearing in mind that England and Wales have introduced it successfully, that was a reasonable baseline to be supplemented with a licensing scheme where that was necessary. And I think Lord Bonamy has commented that the two together form a workable and something that he could be supportive of.
OK, I'll come back to my next point later.
Thank you. Beatrice Wishart.
Good morning, panel. What's the government's understanding of the most common methods of fox control in Scotland, and do you have data on the prevalence of different methods and on whether they change throughout the year? And if so, based on this evidence, will restricting the use of dogs affect a smaller or larger portion of fox control in Scotland?
So, yes, the methods of control... So, first of all, I would say this bill is not just about foxes. So we have to remember that the things that we've pursued are not just about foxes, it's about all wild mammals. But there are a number of ways to control foxes that are used in Scotland. We know that lamping is used. We know that the use of flushing, dogs to flush to guns, or indeed unlawfully to chase and kill dogs to foxes, is being used. And equally, we know that some farmers and land managers adopt traps and snares and things like that. This bill is not about making an assessment on the different ways that Scotland manages foxes. This bill is about saying that the attempt that was made 20 years ago to not allow the chasing and killing as a form of control hasn't worked, and that we really ought to revise the legislation so that that one specific part works as it was intended to. Now, I think there'll be debates about all the other different types of control, but that's not what the bill's looking at. This is very much about how is one aspect of that working, and is it working as the public thought it was under the 20-year-old legislation?
Thank you.
Jenny Minto.
Convener, thank you for coming along and joining us on the panel. Beatrice Wishart has actually covered most of the questions that I had in this area. However, I just following on from the comments that both Karen Adam and Alistair Allen have made, we've had some evidence about the definition of non-native species and how that's been established in the Act, both from the RSPB and the Law Society. I don't know if you want to comment on that.
My understanding of the definition that's been used is one that is used across the piece in legislation. I understand it's derived from EU retained law, and something that I was pleased about is the fact that we have the ability to amend and add to it. But if there was specific issues with regards to the definition, I'm happy to address them. But I think that was mainly the points that came up. Yeah, I think the fact that we're able to add and remove from it, having flexibility, is important.
Good, thank you.
Thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Sorry, convener, I apologise. Hugh was trying to come in there, and I didn't realise.
I would just add that it's not only the species on that list which are eligible for control as non-native species. There's also Part B, which is species which are not native to the area, in which the activity is taking place, and species likely to have a significant adverse impact on biodiversity, etc. So it's under those categories. that control of species like the hedgehogs on Uist that the Minister mm-hmm. referred to earlier, or stoats on Orkney, they would fall under that leg of the criteria rather than the list.
Thank you for confirming that.
Thank you.
Ariane Burgess.
Thank you, Convener. In a previous evidence session, Robbie Kernaghan from NatureScot made the point that when you have too many exceptions, they become unexceptional. Some stakeholders, including League Against Cruel Sports and Scottish Badgers, are concerned that this bill may be in danger of having too many exceptions for it to fulfil the Scottish Government's original intentions. Can I ask you for your thoughts on that?
Yes, of course. So I think it's a good point. I mean, we are working with two core offences. We're working with a suite of exceptions, and then we're working with two exceptions to the exceptions. I think that of the four, this is where we get tongue-tied, but of the four original exceptions, I think that they are right. I think they reflect the realities of when people are required to undertake control of wild mammals. And I think I mentioned earlier the RSPB's welcoming of one of the exceptions, the environmental benefit exception, because that was not part of the 2002 Act. They clearly think, and I don't have their quote in front of me, so I don't want to, you know, misquote them, but I think what they were saying was that this was a welcome addition to their tools in the landscape scale management of our land that they undertake. And of the licensing schemes, I very much come from the place that these licensing schemes are correct. I think that it would be wrong for the government to see what Bonamy had said, that there will be circumstances where two dogs are not sufficient to undertake a legal activity of flushing because of terrain, and then to not act on that. So I think that it's correct that they do it. I want it to be a workable licensing scheme. I don't want people who ought to be entitled to use it to feel that they can't, to feel frustrated by the process. But equally, it has to be construed as being the option when there are no other options. And that's how we'll seek to design it with stakeholders.
Thanks for that. I think we're going to be coming a bit more onto licensing in a bit more detail next.
Jim Fairley.
Thanks again, Convener. The Scottish Government's reasons for a one-dog limit below ground, and there's some arguments that say any dog below ground is a welfare risk, and other where circumstances where you need to have two dogs. However, from my own experience, anyone that put two dogs down the same hole shouldn't have terriers in the first place. But there are circumstances where we're told in evidence that there are circumstances where two dogs below ground is actually far better from a welfare point of view. Did you consider the code of conduct, the terror group's code of conduct, in coming to the conclusion that one dog below ground is the maximum?
Thanks, Jim Fairley, for the question. I think this is probably one of the most vexed issues mm-hmm. in the bill, because I think we're presented with something that is a rock and a hard place. I think you've probably defined that pretty well from, you know, drawing on your own experience there. From what I can gauge from your sessions, from my discussions with stakeholders, is that, just as you've characterised it, some view this as a necessary part of control and of management, of which I don't think there are very obvious alternatives that would be any more palatable. And on the other hand, we have very real concerns, as you have expressed, about the animal welfare implications of putting dogs underground, not just for the wild mammal that it's pursuing, but of the terriers themselves. And I've got it here. It was Mike Flynn from the SSPCA who said, "I have grave concerns about dogs underground. I see no reason why you should have to put more than one dog down there. If you get two terriers in a heightened state, they will bite each other. It's not just the fox they will go for. I have grave concerns about using animals underground because there's no way to control them." So I do think that's really concerning. So what we have proposed as the one dog is trying to walk a balance between that, but I'm open-minded about where we take this and what the views are of how this should be dealt with.
Yeah, I think it's very clear that there's going to have to be a balance walked right across this entire bill. And I get that that's exactly what you're trying to do, but I'll leave it there, Convener, we'll short of time.
Yeah. Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if you could say a little about how you feel hunts should or could be monitored going forward. We heard a little from witnesses in the past talking about how police and others have probably relied on video evidence as to how hunts have behaved. I wonder, could you give any thoughts about how you see that going forward, what kind of evidence you believe police would be able to use, and whether that would be based on any form of monitoring?
Yes, yeah, so we had, in the wake of Lord Bonaby's report, hunt monitoring was set up in 2018, before my time, and I understand that the individual that was undertaking that couldn't continue, and then with COVID and other complications, it wasn't, someone else wasn't found. And by that point, we were pursuing the primary legislation. So my position right now is that we are best to get the bill through and then to consider what monitoring is required on the other side. I hope we will have gotten to a point where the law is clear enough, and the application of it is clear enough, and the enforcement of it is clear enough, that we may have negated the need for monitoring. But I think that remains to be seen once we get to the other side of the bill.
And on a slightly different, but not completely different point, one thing that the police said to us was, in giving evidence, was that there were aspects of the bill I think they found it difficult to give an opinion of until they had seen the licence. So I just wonder, are you able to give an indication of when we'll hear more about what the licence scheme will look like in detail?
Yes, so I've tried to be as clear as I possibly can that I'm very keen not to have the licensing scheme rushed, and to have it be developed in consultation with stakeholders, including those who will have to use it. So in terms of timescale, when it will come into force, we'll update Parliament on the coming into force of all aspects of the bill in due course. But Hugh, I don't know if you want to say anything about when we might be able to start developing the terms of the... I mean, we're already talking to stakeholders about it, but is there any formal point at which we could...
No, I mean, we can... I mean, NatureScot are already well aware that this is coming down the road for them as a requirement, and so they're already thinking about how that might work. The legislation sets out the bones of what a licence must and must have in it and the framework, but there's clearly a lot of detail around that. There is no reason why we can't start to develop that as we move through the bill to provide more detail at various stages. I think that would be quite possible to do.
OK. I think that would be good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Rachel Hamilton.
OK, Minister, I've managed to get some words down that will make you and I understand what I'm trying to say here about Section 7 and 7 and 8 on the exceptions before we leave this particular area. The Section 7 exemption and the consequent Section 8 licence for environmental benefit is limited to where the activity is part of a scheme. Okay? And what I'd like to know is, what is a scheme for these purposes, and why has this limitation been included? Because land managers manage foxes for a variety of purposes, including to protect vulnerable species. So would that activity count as a scheme?
Thanks, Rachel Hamilton. I think what's on the face of the bill reflects our understanding of how people are operating right now. So I mentioned what we might call environmental schemes, whereby, for example, invasive non-native species are being controlled on the islands. And the way that we have expressed it in the bill is just trying to reflect how people are using it right now. And I think that there is a difference between, whilst there is a difference between those who would potentially set out for a year-long activity of eradicating an invasive non-native species on an island, to, for example, a farmer finding evidence that there is a fox in his fields or her fields and having to call on support to control that. Those are different activities. I wouldn't refer to that as a scheme. I would just refer to that as the ongoing workings of the farm. But, you know, there's no... I don't think that I'm trying to draw a great distinction here. I don't disagree with you that there will be times when you could refer to what someone maybe is undertaking to protect lambs as a scheme as well. But the bill is just trying to reflect what people are, how people are using dogs in real life.
Do you not think, though, that land managers, as a positive consequence of predation control in terms of however they decide to do it, are then inadvertently, perhaps to them, protecting the environment, but with the new requirements to protect the environment and ground nesting birds and increase the biodiversity species within Scotland, do you not think that this is slightly not considering that by making an exception of a scheme within 7 and 8 rather than considering that predation control is part of that, and therefore that then reflects on how the licence would be applied for, granted, in terms of that generality?
Yeah, I mean, I think your last point there really touched on, if it's not about, if there aren't differences in how long you can apply for the licence for and the terms thereof, I think the difference is theoretical, you know, if it wasn't for those terms. But where the terms exist, I can see that there would be arguments where people might say, well, should I apply under the protection of livestock clause, or should I apply under the environmental protection clause? I mean, the terms of the licensing scheme are still to be developed, so it's difficult for me to give concrete responses to that. But certainly our purpose in this has been to try and reflect the ways in which people need to call on the use of dogs in land management throughout Scotland. And, you know, finding that there's a fox present in fields, having to call on support for that is a different matter to a large-scale environmental project, which is about invasive non-native species. But there's no deliberate, you know, there's no pursuit on our part of not calling protection of livestock an environmental issue, because it is. You know, so I'm not, there's a sort of theoretical
distinction. I think maybe we need to work that through. I think it is a good thing to air as part of the sort of practicalities of improving animal welfare in general. And also, I just want to pick up a point. You mentioned that the Scottish Government has assessed the use of two dogs. I don't know whether it's to Jim or somebody else, but can you write to the committee with that detail? Is it a document that's been published, or?
I can certainly write to the committee with
some of
what we considered when we developed the two dog
permit.
Thank you. Just building on that, so why does the bill distinguish between environmental and purposes and the control of livestock? And why do environmental benefits have to be part of a scheme? Because surely foxes or other wild mammals, if this bill is all about animal welfare, foxes or other wild mammals will not have a different welfare experience depending on why they're being culled. So why is there a difference between environmental purposes or livestock when this is all about animal welfare? Because a fox doesn't know whether it's been culled for killing lambs or whether it's been controlled for disturbing ground nesting birds. So why even bother distinguishing between the two?
I think we have to bother to distinguish because what we're trying to do is make something work which hasn't worked to now. So we have, you know, it's incumbent on us to be specific about the circumstances in which it's going to be okay or permissible to use an exception under a rule. And clarity and specificity is what we're trying to achieve in the bill. I did try and set out in response to Rachel Hamilton about how I think, you know, I'm not saying that control of livestock isn't an environmental issue, but there is a distinction in reality, in practical terms, about someone requiring assistance with protection of livestock and a long-term project for invasive non-native species eradication on an island. They just are different. I don't think the welfare issues are different, but they're just different activities. But if I haven't done that clearly enough, I'll maybe hand over to my colleague Hugh to see if there's anything he can add.
Well, just a couple of things. I mean, clearly, control of foxes to protect livestock is likely to have environmental benefits as well. We appreciate that it will benefit other species other than the livestock. It's being protected. And there are certainly a range of sort of farmer or led schemes, like the Working for Waders scheme, for example, where we would easily see that fitting into the environmental criteria. The other point that I would make on this is there is a difference, picking up on the convener's point, between Section 7 and Section 3, and that is that the activities which are permitted under Section 7 are capturing and observing as well, whereas under Section 3 it's just killing to protect livestock. So this recognises that you may be using dogs not just for the purposes of killing the species that you're flushing, but also of photographing, researching, and so on. So in that way, it will be that's possibly an easier bar to get through.
Yeah, thank you for that clarity. That is helpful. Mercedes Villalba.
Thank you, Convener. And please forgive me if this is outlined elsewhere and I may have missed it, but could the Minister explain in what circumstances you envisage a licence being issued? And is it intended that there'll be regular reviews of the licensing scheme to make sure that it's meeting its purpose?
So, two parts to the question. The first part is I can't give detail today on the content of the licence beyond that which is set out in the bill. The bill sets out the mandatory requirements of what will need to be in it, but the development of it and the terms of it will be informed by this process, by the stakeholder engagement that we are already undertaking. In terms of reviewing, however, Nature Scot will review the operation of this, as they do the operation of all of the licensing schemes and other matters that they are in charge of. And in the Bute House Agreement, there is a commitment to review the operation of licensing schemes generally to make sure that they are up to compatible with the law and in line with our expectations. And this will form part of that as well.
Thank you for that response. And so can I just confirm, are you saying that that detail will be in the bill at stage two, or it's something for once the bill becomes an act that the licensing... I'm just not sure on the process.
No, you're quite right. So I think it was in response to Alistair Allen earlier that Hugh said that we would keep... So we're undertaking engagement with stakeholders throughout the development of the bill. We're also listening closely to the evidence that you take, and all of that will feed into Nature Scot's development of the terms of the licensing scheme. I think Hugh was saying earlier that we would be happy to keep Parliament up to date as that develops, but this will be something which will come post, you know, it'll be finalised after the passage of the bill, as has been the case with other pieces of legislation. Most recently, I think, the Animals and Wildlife Bill, when we brought hares within protected status and we designed and finalised the licensing scheme for them after the passage of the bill.
Thank you. So that's...
Just going to move on to licensing. We've kind of jumped the gun. So, Jenny Minto, please.
Convener, I would wonder, Minister, if you could just, for the record, explain why the Scottish Government has decided to introduce a licence, and then perhaps some of the discussions already been around the 14 days versus the 2 years for control versus environmental reasons. And I think you've also quoted, or you've said that you want it to be correct, workable and practical. Mm. So from my constituency's perspective and other large areas of Scotland, it's thinking about how small farmers, as opposed to the foot packs, operate in that area. So I'd just like your thoughts on that, please.
Sure, thank you for the question. So I think I've mentioned it a couple of times, but just for clarity in response to that question, the principal reason for the licensing scheme being tagged on to two of the exceptions is that we recognise, as Lord Bonamy did, that there are certain circumstances in which two dogs will not allow that lawful activity of flushing to waiting guns to take place. And he was specific about terrain being one of the reasons why that might not be workable on hill ground or in thick forests. So in recognition of that, we have introduced the licensing scheme. It's an exception to an exception. And I, you know, we talk about balance a lot. I want all of us to try and get to a point where we have a licensing scheme that's workable, available to those where there's no other option, where a farmer, for example, if they need it, if it's during a busy lambing period, that they're not unduly burdened by it. But at the same time, we can't allow it to become, you know, so weak that we're right back to where we were in 2002, where they can just be readily applied for and nobody knows anymore why and what's actually happening in the countryside. So that's what we need to avoid. And just on the timings, again, this was just about Scottish Government trying to reflect our understanding of how they were used in practice. And I've given the example of a farmer seeing evidence that there's foxes around, applying for, you know, maybe they'll be able to undertake the control with two dogs. If not, and if there's no other options, being able to apply for a licence for 14 days to have that dealt with. Because we understand that those are the timescales in which it should be possible to do. And then the longer term projects that we've observed, including the Stoats on Orkney, who are being name checked a lot today, but the longer schemes have required more time. But I think the 2 years is a maximum. It's not a general rule.
If I may, Minister, could you expand on your line possible to do? Is that to do when you were talking about the 14 days? Because some farmers have come to me and have said that they feel that's a difficult time frame to work in. So it might be helpful to understand the evidence, the backup that you've had to the 14 days.
Yes, that's fine, and perhaps I can include some more of that in the when we write to you about what we consider in the development of the $2 limit. But I have to say, it's largely a reflection of what we've been told about what is necessary.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But on the same token, if I'm being told that's not going to work, I'm not closed-minded to that because I don't want this to not work. I don't want it to be available and undermine what we're trying to do here. But where it's needed, I don't want it to be a fudge.
OK, that's great. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. I'm very conscious that we've got about 15 minutes left. Have you the flexibility to go over the 90 minutes we've allocated?
I will do, and I might need to cancel something that's next. If
you're
check.
Able to do that, you can appreciate there's a lot of questions to come.
Absolutely.
What I don't want to do, it's one of these situations where we've got some detail in the middle of our session. Towards the end, there might not be quite... The questions and responses are maybe not quite so long, but I don't want to stifle this section of our questioning. If you do have some flexibility, that would be very much appreciated.
No, I want to accommodate what I can. What time do you think we might finish?
Maybe an additional 15 minutes.
OK, no, that's fine. That's fine.
Thank you. I really appreciate that. Just in the back of Jenny Minto's question, are you open to suggestions of a different method or different length of days? So 14 days is very prescriptive, and we know weather conditions or whatever could play a part in whether the pest control taking part within those 40 days is effective or not effective. There has been suggestions in some places you could have an annual licence which allowed X number of days to use dogs for hunting for pest control purposes. Are you open to suggestions on a flexible licence that would allow not a specific 14-day period, but maybe X number of days over an annual calendar period?
I suppose there is a multitude of ways in which we could do this, and I'm open-minded to the ways we can do it, which allow us to strike that balance, which I expressed before to Jenny Minto, which is about achieving what we want to achieve here, highest possible animal welfare standards, no chasing and killing of wild mammals in the countryside, but equally facilitating those who, for whom two dogs is not enough and for whom there are no other methods. I am recalling that something we've discussed so far is that you wouldn't necessarily require to resubmit evidence every time for an application for a licence. But this is all to be worked out, frankly. But something like the weather convener, you know, that's a practical reality which I would want to see reflected. Hugh, yeah, please do.
Yeah, just to add a couple of quick thoughts on this business about a sort of annual licence to be used at different days. I can see the appeal of it, but I think there will also inevitably be considerations as to when is an appropriate time to use more than two dogs. There will be considerations around nesting birds, maybe considerations around the presence of other species which may need to be taken into account. So I think that would probably be seen to be quite a large degree of flexibility and loss of control over the possible impact of those dogs. In terms of things like weather holding up the use of a licence, I would certainly expect NatureScot to be flexible in being told it's been snowing, it's been too wet, we can't do it, can we do it the following 2 weeks, and without having to resubmit the whole application. That would clearly make sense.
Okay, thank you. We're going to move on. A question from Jim Fairley.
Thanks very much, Convener. I'm actually going to just, Hugh, if you don't mind, I'm going to come back to you on this particular point. And it does tie into my next question, if that's okay. The type of licence, if you're going to have a seasonal licence, I'm going back to, I'm sorry, you're not following what's going on in my head. I'm thinking back to what the Minister was talking about earlier on with dogs going to ground. Nobody wants dogs going to ground. That would be the last thing that we want to be doing. But if you leave the licence to the point where you're in lambing time, for instance, foxes are already going to be in the ground, so you're going to have more dogs going underground rather than flushing. So I've made this point in several of the sessions before about having the licence to preempt cubbing time in order to stop more terriers going underground. Is that something that you'll be prepared to look at? Sorry, maybe it should have been addressed to yourself, Minister, I don't know. But I'm just concerned that we get the timing wrong and have it too prescriptive in terms of having to get a licence.
Well, yeah, I mean, I don't think there's any prescription as to when that 2 weeks should be. The person who thinks, anticipates they need the licence should apply for it for the time when they think it will be most used to them.
But it's that two-week period that I am concerned with. For me, being a practical land manager, it should be over a period of time, out with nesting season and when we know that they're not going to ground to cub. And there's plenty of scope to have a season to allow hounds on the ground to be able to flush particular areas where you know you're just not going to be able to get out with a lamp. So would the bill be able to consider that specification?
I think I understand what you're saying, and we've come to this on the basis that we will consider how to make things workable. Now, that's a whole series of issues, including timing.
I fully understand the difficulty that you have trying to walk that fine line. The other question was the other conditions that you may put on. Again, I've raised this in a number of committees before. Is the number of guns who are on the other side as important as the number of dogs that are flushing? Because if you've got two dogs, and I maybe made it to you the last time we were here, Hugh, if you've got two guns covering 150 yards of forestry, foxes are going to go straight through the middle and they're going to get chased. If you've got 15 guns, the fox isn't going anywhere other than being shot. So is the number of guns as important in the licensing as the number of dogs?
So I have been thinking about this since I heard it being discussed before, and I understand the reasoning behind it is to make sure that shot happens as soon as possible, to avoid that chasing happening, the killing happening, which is cruel and unlawful, and it's what we want to avoid. I think that it would be difficult to include something like that on the face of the bill because there'll be different circumstances in which dogs are being used. I think it could be considered as part of the development of terms of a licensing scheme. But
is it something that NatureScot could have the local understanding
therefore that building up that relationship? Because one of the other things we've spoken about in this committee is there's going to have to be a working relationship between Nature Scotland land managers, and could that be part of, built into that relationship?
I think Nature Scotland already have a relationship with land managers, and they'll seek to foster that to make this work in whatever way we need to. And I think, you know, as I've said, I don't think it's appropriate for the face of the bill. I don't see why it shouldn't be considered as part of the development of licensing.
OK, thank you.
Ariane Burgess.
The committee has heard and read evidence from several witnesses who do not agree with the need for a licensing scheme and are concerned that it will leave open loopholes for traditional fox hunting to continue. But if there will be a licensing scheme, do you believe it would benefit from incorporating some of the principles set out in Alison Johnson's proposed members' bill from last session on protecting Scotland's wild mammals? And some of these included that there should be no negative impact on the local or national conservation status of the species in question, that licences should be issued where there is a risk that dependent young will suffer, and that licences must be conditional on reporting how many animals have been killed or hunted for publication by the licensing authority. Could I ask the Minister whether the Scottish Government has considered these and other licensing principles suggested by my former colleague's proposed members' bill?
Thanks, Ariane Burgess, for the question. I think that for the purposes of today and stage one, it's a similar comment to that which I made in response to Jim Fairley, that all of these issues are already being and will continue to be considered as the terms of the licence are developed. For my part, at this stage, I'm content that what's on the face of the bill allows us to develop a licensing scheme which will be rigorous and which will cover the basis that it needs to. But it's a framework almost at this point, and we will build into it with through consultation and through stakeholder engagement. One of the most important things for me, and I know from speaking to some stakeholders, it's important for them as well, is that this is built on the idea that the licensing scheme is available where no other option exists. And that, you know, that's pretty robust as far as I'm concerned.
Thanks for that response. So I'm hearing from that response that there's scope in the process of the bill process. Thanks very much. And I've got, so as already noted, several stakeholders, including League Against Cruel Sports and OneKind, are concerned that the exceptions and licences in the bill will leave open loopholes for practices that are cruel to animals to continue, just like what happened with the Protection of Badgers Act. Minister McCallum, to reassure stakeholders and the 87% of the public who are in favour of a watertight ban on traditional fox hunting, are you confident that no licences will be granted to any of the 10 mounted hunts in Scotland that currently hunt with dogs 2 to 4 times a week for 5 or 6 months of the year?
I'm not going to, because this is a criminal issue, I'm not going to cast aspersions on the reasons for which any hunt has gone out in the past. But what I will say is that I'm absolutely confident that passed, this bill can stop the illegal activity of chasing and killing an animal in Scotland's countryside, and will facilitate legitimate control under strict circumstances.
Thank you.
Lord Mountain.
Thank you, Convener. And I know this is the second time I've been to this committee, but I'd like to remind the committee that I do have an interest in a family farm, which doesn't have lambs on it, so I may be thankful. But, Minister, just a couple of comments on the licensing, which I think are interesting to pick up on, is, and I think Jim Fairley's right in what he says, you know, hunting or flushing a fox out of a wood can be actually preventative if it's moving it on, i.e. before the lambing period starts, because foxes will obviously use the same ground on an annual basis. So if you move them on before lambing. What concerns me, though, is it's talking about evidence of damage. Now, if all lambing goes on in Scotland in a very short period of time and there's evidence of damage, it has to be submitted, and then everyone will be wanting to use the same dogs for the same 14-day period to flush their foxes out of the woods to waiting guns. How are you going to address that, Minister?
I understand. You can see I'm speaking to my colleagues here. I understand the point that I don't want people to have to get to the stage of being able to demonstrate that the damage has been done. You know, we don't want dead lambs to be evidence that the licence was needed, but there's an understanding amongst Scottish Government, among Nature Scot, and drawing on the expertise of farmers and land managers that you don't need to wait until the lambs have been come into contact with the fox in order to justify the control of the fox.
Okay. I'll be interested to see how that licence pans out, and Mr Dingham will know that in previous licensing schemes, gamekeepers were required to keep poults in a freezer till they'd been inspected by SNH to prove that they'd been damaged by species. But, Minister, Lord Bonamy made a very interesting point that to do with the ground and the area of ground covered, how many dogs would be required. You know, to cover a 200-acre block of forestry, you're going to need more than half a dozen guns and you're going to need more than two dogs. What do you think would be an acceptable level of dogs in your mind? You said you've been thinking about licensing. If somebody applied for 10 dogs, would that be sufficient or would that be too many in your mind? Would 15? Where's the limit?
Thanks for the question. Just to pick up on the previous point, I've just had a quick glance at the legislation and it does account for preventing damage. So we don't need to wait to the point where the damage has been done.
Thank you.
As regards minimum number of dogs, that is all dependent on the activity, the land, the issue at hand, and I'm not going to theorise at this stage about what would be a suitable number because there are so many variables that I couldn't possibly be accurate.
Okay, Convener, if I could just come back on that one point. So you have no preconceptions on the amount of dogs that may be required in any circumstances? Because, I mean, the aim, as you rightly say, is to get the fox out as quickly as possible and shot as quickly as possible without it being chased. So that's going to need more than two dogs. So you've no preconception on the number of dogs.
My preconception is the minimum number to fulfil what is needed across the space of land, depending on what size that is, or the issue at hand. And I'm really not able to sit here and say what that would be in all those multitude of scenarios, but my preconception is the minimum number required to fulfil the job in hand.
Thank you. So no preconceptions on numbers. Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you for the committee to allow me to ask.
Thank you. Just on the back of that, Nature Scot will be expected to determine the number of dogs in each licence. How are they going to go about that? Will they have a licence for up to 10 dogs, a licence for up to 40 dogs, a licence up to... How do you... what's your understanding of what the process Nature Scot will have to go through to determine the number of dogs in a licence?
So, again, it goes back to the bones of the licensing scheme. As it's set out in the bill, I think explicitly refers to the minimum number required. And thereafter, it will be for Nature Scot experts in this, which... Of course, I'm a politician, I'm not an expert in this, to determine, according to the circumstances in the in front of them, per you know, the farmer's size of farm, size of the fields, number of sheep, the size of the environmental project, the rate of spread of the invasive non-native species, all that has to be taken into account, and I couldn't possibly sit here and determine what that was.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to move on to questions from Rachel Hamilton, then Jenny Minto.
Just before that, I just want to respond to Edward Mountain's point there, because and get it on record that within the review that Bonamy actually concluded, importantly, that restricting the number of dogs could seriously compromise effective pest control in the country. And Bonamy's been quoted a lot today, so I just wanted to get that on the record, Convener. But moving on to the point exactly that you make there and the way that the Minister responded in terms of the resource that may be needed to determine the number of licences. We talked a lot about licences today, but it is important because we need, obviously, to get this right. So there has been a cut in the budget, £700,000 to Nature Scot. Wondered how they, with all the requirements that you've just listed in terms of that evidential requirement, be able to do their job right across Scotland from north to south, east to west.
Yep. No, it's a reasonable question, and it's a discussion that we have already been having for some time with Nature Scot, making sure that there's a clear understanding about the additional work that comes with an additional licensing scheme and their capacity to fulfil that. And they have assured us thus far that that's manageable within their current budget.
Okay, so we haven't obviously even got to stage one yet, but there hasn't been that consultation on the licence scheme, and therefore it's very difficult to determine how, if they can, with a reduced budget, current budget, be able to fulfil those requirements. So do you think it might be worth looking at the financial implications within that consultation?
So we do have a financial memorandum which was published with the stage one, with the bill, and it's on the basis of that, and also Nature Scots' experience of administering similar schemes, that they have assured us that they have sufficient resources to develop and to administer the scheme.
Yes, I think within the financial memorandum, I don't have it in front of me, but I'm sure it said it doesn't create any additional resource to bodies or stakeholders.
In front of me,
no, we'll check on that.
Okay.
Just on the point there that, about the consultation, because that's obviously something that's quite important, getting that feedback from stakeholders and practitioners. And in the rural sector evidence that we heard, a number of the witnesses had said that they have a group which is based on rural working group stakeholders. I wondered if you'd had the opportunity to meet with them and hear how those people that represent land managers and farmers can be part of this process.
Okay, sorry, Hugh was just reminding me what REALM stands for. I have undertaken meetings across the piece, and I've tried very actively to engage with everyone who has an interest in this, and I've always said from the beginning that I'm particularly interested in developing policy that people, you know, people who are going to be affected by it understand. On the specific point about REALM, my colleague Leah was just telling me that she's been invited to that and will be attending.
Okay, that's fantastic. Do you want me to conclude my questions in one go rather than coming back?
No, I'll move to Jenny Minto. Jenny's got a bigger pardon. Do you? I've got you down as having a supplementary here. Is that right?
I did, but Rachel's covered quite a bit of it. But I think we could probably move on to, as well, the licence. If the bill is passed and the licensing is brought in, how will the Scottish Government monitor the information that Nature Scot is providing to ensure that the licence is as appropriate as it should be?
I think it's a really good point. Similar to that which Mercedes Villalba raised earlier about reviewing. So I think from the Scottish Government's perspective, we have an interest and a duty to understand that the laws that we pass and the licensing schemes that are developed are working properly, and we have a Bute House agreement to review across the piece that's the case. Nature Scot will be responsible for monitoring, evaluating and reviewing the scheme for their purposes, and I think back to when Robbie Kernahan was in front of the committee, I think he was quite clear that they embraced that role and would be undertaking that. Oh, and sorry, Hugh's just reminding me that they'll be publishing the data, which, of course, is a helpful form of scrutiny.
Mm-hmm. OK. Rich, were your questions on licensing?
Well, it was... I'd asked this consecutively during the evidence sessions, and it was really about if there was no alternative method of controlling predators, and so Nature Scot was satisfied, but... there was a demonstration that there had been loss. Is there any other scheme or example that you could cite that would offer compensation for loss of livelihood, loss of livestock?
Oh, loss of livestock. Okay, sorry.
I meant livelihood in terms of income because of loss of livestock.
So I briefly heard this being discussed before, and our position just now is that we are not considering provision of compensation.
Okay. And continuing on that theme, are you considering the possibility of allowing an appeal process?
There is. So I believe very firmly in appeal processes. And there is an internal review and appeal process within Nature Scot. It was explained to me when I asked the same question as being, you know, the structure within Nature Scot that deals with that. So there is one there. But I am, well, very supportive and keen to see that review and appeal processes are there and available.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Just before we move on from licensing, we touched on the financial capacity within Nature Scot, and I understand it's about 118,000 is the estimate of what the cost to Nature Scot will be. Does that involve any cost recovery from those applying for licences, and is there any consideration of charging for licences? And is going forward, are the total cost estimated to be 118,000?
So that doesn't presently involve cost recovery, but it could do if that was something that was sought.
Okay, and that would be in secondary legislation?
Well, it would depend. There's a provision within the bill as it stands, I think, to allow us to make supplementary changes. And if that bill, if that section were passed with the Act, I think we would be able to do it through that, although I hope my legal colleagues aren't cringing at me. You know, assuming that, but I would think that would be the provision through which to do it.
Perhaps, Hazel, can you make it clear exactly what powers this bill would give Scottish Government to charge for licences? What's the scope?
I would just come in there and add that across all wildlife legislation, so the Wildlife and Countryside Act and the Conservation Natural Habitat Regulations at the moment, they're not run on a cost recoverable basis, but there is provision for Nature Scot should they decide to bring that in to do so, I think administratively, but happy to clarify that in writing if
that would be useful. Thank you. We're now going to move on to prohibition on trail hunting, which is covered in sections 11 and 12. Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener. We heard last week from Police Scotland that making trail hunting illegal to limit the opportunities for people who want to disguise illegal hunting as a legal act is alone not necessarily reason enough to make trail hunting illegal. So what's your view and what impact do you believe prohibition will have in Scotland?
Yeah, thank you for the question. So I think it goes back to something that I tried to convey in my opening remarks, which is about closing the loopholes of the previous Act, but equally taking this opportunity to ensure that more don't open. And the issue of trail hunting falls into that category very squarely. The reasons that we've decided to ban it are twofold. Firstly, because we think there is an animal welfare risk, whereby if an animal is being trained to follow an animal-based scent, it can very easily pick up the scent of an animal elsewhere, begin chasing that, begin the chase and kill, which is exactly what we're trying to stop. That's just one part of why we're doing it. The second reason we are banning it is because we've seen evidence from down south that trail hunting is being used as a cover for the continuance of illegal hunting. So we want to not allow that to begin in Scotland. And it's not a well-established practice, so I think this ought not to be something that's controversial or difficult, but it's about making sure that we don't allow more loopholes to open.
About prevention, then?
Prevention, exactly.
Yeah. Okay. I did have a question about police dogs, but I think that's Karen's down for that question, so I'll leave it there. So
I'll bring in Karen, and if it's not covered, I'll bring you back in. Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. Excuse me. In regards to trail hunting, it has been made controversial by opposing groups. And there have been calls for impact assessments and such like. I was wondering, have you considered doing that, or do you feel that there has been enough evidence?
On the banning of trail hunting?
Yes.
I'm content just now that for the two policy reasons that we've pursued it, sitting against the fact that it's not a well-established practice in Scotland, that this is a proportionate measure to take.
Okay, thank you, thank you for that. And also, Police Scotland have commented and given opinion that there maybe should be some exemptions, particularly for training police dogs. I wonder if you've had any comment on that.
Yes, so I think that's a really important point that Police Scotland made. It wasn't one that had been raised with me previously, but now that it has, I'm going to consider how we can accommodate the training of police dogs.
Okay, that's great. Thank you.
Thank you. And Beatrice had covered. Okay, and now on to enforcement, which is part three of the bill. A question from Alistair Allen.
Briefly on the issue of enforcement, I just wondered if you had a view about the powers of search that exist in the bill. The Law Society had questions about whether those powers were sufficient in every instance.
Yeah, I think this is another interesting point, quite similar to that with the training of police dogs. We wouldn't want to do anything that got in the way of the operation of Police Scotland's duties. The stop and search powers, sorry, the absence of stop and search powers in this bill reflects the Animals and the 2006 Act.
Animal Welfare Protection Powers.
Animal Health and Welfare Protection Scotland Act 2006, which didn't contain stop and search. But like with the training of police dogs, we will speak to Police Scotland again and see whether something needs to be accommodated, perhaps at a later stage.
Thank you.
Jenny Minto.
Sorry, Convener, I tried to indicate I didn't. Oh,
OK, that's fine. Back to Karen. Have you got an additional question?
Yes, thanks, Convener. It was just to ask for any comments in regards to the Law Society, who said that the ancillary powers for Scottish ministers to modify any enactment, they felt that that was maybe quite broad, and I wonder if you had comment on that.
Yes, and I take on board what the Law Society Scotland say. However, that is a pretty standard provision throughout not just wildlife legislation, but throughout legislation generally. And it will allow us, should amendments need to be made, and the convener and I had an example of where that might be, but I can't exactly. Oh, cost recovery was an example of where we might want to make changes. That would allow us to do it via, you know, not having to go through primary legislation again, or indeed to any deficiencies that arose as compared with the 2002 Act, that provision would allow us to make the changes and not have to bring another bill. So I don't think it's an overstretch. I think it's quite a standard part of drafting.
That's great. Thank you.
Just on that, you know, the Law Society did raise concerns, so it must be more than just a general clause, if you like. So they consider the need for subsequent guidance and prosecution policy. Will that be forthcoming?
So I can bring in Hazel on this. All I would say is that, and I should have made this clear in my answer to Karen Adam, that it's clauses in to give effect to and in pursuit of the bill itself, not anything out with the scope of it. But Hazel, I don't know if there's anything you want to add to that.
Yeah, I'm happy to come in, Minister. Certainly, I think the Law Society were focusing on sort of one very narrow part of that provision, which states that it can be used to modify any enactment. However, that is very much caveated by subsection 1 of that provision, that it is for the purposes of or in connection with or for giving full effect to any provision of the bill. So that does limit the extent of the power. And certainly, I would just reiterate that it is a clause that you will see in many acts of the Scottish Parliament. And I also note that the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee made no comment in relation to the power.
OK, thank you. Arianne Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. I think anything, context really matters. And, you know, so whether it's enforcement or the bill as a whole. And, you know, I'm aware that the UK Committee on Climate Change called for a 20 to 50% cut in the number of sheep and cattle to help combat climate change. So, you know, this is something that's been growing on me in the course of this evidence sessions that we've been having, that I see that we are talking about a context that is as if things are going to stay the same, and yet if we're really going to respond to the nature and climate emergencies, then the way in which we farm is going to change, and then the way in which we need to manage our land is going to change. And I just wonder if you've had any considerations around that as you've been drafting the bill.
I'm not sure that is actually applicable to the bill that's in front of us, which is about animal welfare aspects. But if the Minister wishes to make comment, but I don't think you should feel obliged, because it's not really covered in this bill.
Yeah, no, I would agree, Convener. I was going to say I didn't think that it pertained to the purpose. All I would say is that the government have to consider climate change as is already baked in, and where we're going in all of the legislation that we develop. But I think food policy and animal wildlife management and welfare are two separate issues.
And yet they are connected. Absolutely. Yes. And I think this is one of the problems that we've had on this committee, is that we need to recognise that they are connected.
Okay. I think that's Rachel Hamilton.
Just for consistency, convener, thank you. I did ask Police Scotland about, you know, in the deprivation orders in terms of the seizing of vehicles and horses and quad bikes and things like that. It's really speaking to my point about financial resource for Police Scotland as well, and the consideration that they don't have some of those facilities, certainly for keeping hounds or dogs, or they do have dog kennels, obviously, but not horses, as you know, you might say. I don't think we'll be talking many here or many quad bikes, but I think it's important to recognise, Minister, that it could have a financial implication.
Absolutely. No, I think it's a fair point, and we, as we work with Nature Scot about the financial implications for them, we will work with Police Scotland. I should say the SSPCA play a really important role in helping Police Scotland to manage some of the resource issues here, including the rehoming of animals and things. And we are due to undertake a bit of work reviewing the powers of the SSPCA as they pertain to wildlife crime. And perhaps that will play into some of this. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you, Minister, and your team, and I really appreciate the additional time you gave us. My 15-minute estimate wasn't too far over, so thank you very much for attending today, and your fullest of answers were very much appreciated, and we look forward to working with you as the bill progresses. We're now going to briefly suspend the meeting to allow witnesses to leave, and for a short comfort break, we'll resume at 11:55. Our second item of business today is consideration of three instruments that are subject to the negative parliamentary procedure. The Seed Fees Scotland Amendments Regulation 2022, SSI 2022/186. The Meat Preparations Import Conditions Scotland Amendment Regulations 2022, SSI 2022/193. And lastly, the Vegetable Plant Material and Fruit Plant and Propagating Material EU Exit Scotland Amendment Regulations 2022. And I refer members to page 3. To paper 3, page 24. Do any members have any comments on the instruments? No? Okay. The next item of consideration is a consent notification relating to two UKSIs, namely the Aquatic Animal Health Amendments Regulation 2022 and the Animal Foods Feed Plant Health Plant Propagation Material and Seeds Miscellaneous Amendments, etc., Regulations 2022, and I refer members to paper 4, page 38. Do members have any comments on either of these notifications? No. In relation to the Aquatic Animal Health Regulations, are members content with the proposal to write to the Scottish Government to ask how many, to ask how any disputes between the three UK administrations over amendments to relevant lists would be resolved, and also to highlight the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee, the changing role for the Scottish Parliament as a result of this SI. Okay, and do we agree with the Scottish Government's decision to consent to the provisions set out in the notifications being included in UK rather than Scottish subordinate legislation? Agreed. And that concludes our business in public, and we'll now move into private session. Thank you.